And welcome aboard, friends. Thank you for popularizing the show called Know the Cause. I'm your humbled host. My name is Doug Kaufman. You know, I don't know if I worry about cancer as much as cancer treatment. They say by the time a guy is my age, he's had prostate cancer a few times. I just didn't go to the doctor, so I have no idea if I had it. And it's gone, and I'm still alive. Knock on wood. The bottom line to this is the American Society for Radiation Oncology released a list of 5 oncology treatments just recently that are commonly ordered but may not be appropriate. Are you with me? Is it the cancer we should worry about or the treatments that may not be appropriate? They released a new list every year. I remember one time Madame Curie invented, you know, radium, and she died at a young age, so did her spouse, because they're exposed to all this radiation. So on that list, and these are radiation oncologists, on that list is the very thing they deal with every day, avoid radiation. So we go to a dentist and they put a lead vest over us and they say, I'm gonna take your x-rays. Not my dentist. Every year I have to sign, no you're not. And it gets so deep. Everybody wanting to do radiation and mammograms and so forth on us. Just be careful out there, folks, because this list said there are 5 treatments that doctors, oncologists order very commonly, and they may not be appropriate. We need to start thinking more than doing. Put your thinking cap on. Don't worry about cancer as much as worrying about cancer therapies. You know, we here at Know the Cause are so excited because Oncology News, the November issue of Oncology News, finally we have a feature article in it. Here's the headline, Fungi and their Mycotoxins, an Underappreciated Role in Cancer. Big words, right? What this article says is, I think fungus is intimately involved in the disease cancer, and we finally got it published in a medical journal, and a good one, Oncology News. Now, let's go back to the beginning for some of you. Many of you have attended one of my conferences where I talk about this, but many of you haven't been able to do that either, and so what I want to do is make this really simple for you and show you how I believe fungus starts a whole fire that we call cancer. Fungus spews a poison. Right? Many fungi off-gas, and that poison is called a mycotoxin. So let's get started. Number one, let's study cancer. Has an incredible, credible science been totally overlooked? That's kind of the overview of this article. Is cancer a chronic mycotoxicosis? Okay, let's talk about this word, chronic mycotoxicosis. Mycotoxicosis. What does that mean? Look at this slide. Chronic means long duration. I've been chronically in love with Ruth for 35 years. Myco means fungus. Toxic is poison. Osis in medicine means action or process. So a chronic mycotoxicosis is a long process of poisoning caused by fungus. As I said earlier, fungal poisons are called mycotoxins. This is literally unlike bacteria. It's unlike viri. You know, doctors for years have published on maybe bacteria is what causes cancer. Maybe virus is what causes cancer. Maybe not. Fungal cells and human cells, as you'll see, are very much alike. Next slide says a mycotoxicosis. Any illness caused by any mycotoxin. We've talked about penicillium, the mold, becoming penicillin, the poison. It just kills bacteria. We haven't talked so much about brewer's yeast as the fungus, but alcohol is the poison it makes, or the mycotoxin. A hangover is the end result, because some mycotoxins are neurotoxic. They're toxic to the brain. Any doctor who says mycotoxins don't cause any problem, simply have him drink a bottle of gin, and then see if he has enough poison in his body to cause his limbic system, his neurological system, to become poisoned where he can't talk, he can't walk, he can't sit up anymore. Doctors know that something in alcohol does that. Unfortunately, folks, not many doctors understand that this fungus creates a poison. The grain has a poison on it, or the fruit, in the case of some wines, have a poison on it, and it is that poison that kind of numbs our neurological system. Anytime we induce a symptom or disease using a mycotoxin, a fungal mycotoxin, that disease always should be called a mycotoxicosis. But is it? How do researchers study cancer? They use laboratory animals. They must first induce cancer in that animal. But look what they do. They inoculate them with a mycotoxin called aflatoxin B1 or AFB1. What is this? AFB1 is the most hepatotoxic, that's liver toxic, and carcinogenic, cancer-causing, of the aflatoxin, and is an established risk for hepatocarcinogenesis in humans. So says cancer research. It's one thing for Doug Kaufman or one of the publications to say this. These are medical journals that are saying this. It isn't just me. So look at, once again, how do researchers study cancer? They use laboratory animals. Simply put, we're injecting a lab animal, like a rabbit, with a fungus, and then calling the lump they get in their body cancer. Can you believe that? I don't know if doctors would refute that. We are always injecting poisons or carcinogens into laboratory animals to give them cancer. One of them is called a mycotoxin. Here's cancer versus fungus. Human cells and fungal cells are very much alike. They share a rigid cell membrane and a nucleus complete with DNA. If fungal DNA were to merge with human DNA, a completely new hybrid DNA would form. That's not a good thing. You don't want that because scientists wouldn't understand it. They've never seen it. A plant, like a fungus, merging its DNA with a human cell. But look at this. Some fungi grow in a sac-like structure. Doesn't a tumor grow in what looks like a cyst? And they mimic cancer. In 2013, 27 patients were diagnosed with lung cancer, later found to have lung fungus. All 27 were put on antifungal drugs and all lived. I think it's important, folks, that we understand. I think this article that's just been published in Oncology News gives every oncologist in the United States a license to hand out antifungals when they see cancer in their patients. Will they do it? It'll take a few years, but I think they will. Now, when we get back, let's review the medical, not the records, but the bills from a patient who had lung cancer. Don't go away.
I'm not old. I'm 81 years young, okay? I was diagnosed with prostate cancer, I think it was about 3 years ago, and I got on Doug's diet. I heard about him anyway, so the doctor wanted to give me several different shots or have an operation, take these seeds, and I says, no, I'm not going to do anything. So I got on Doug's diet, and I went back in 6 months. And he couldn't find anything. So my brother, he was diagnosed the same as I was. He had an operation, and he's having all kinds of problems now. Real strong on Doug's diet. I don't fall off of the wagon, so I stick right to it, nothing to it. Doug just, I think he's a gem. I've got 3 or 4 of his books, and I watch him quite regular on the Dish Network, Sky Angel, and I'm really thrilled with what I hear. That's about all I can report anyway right now.
Oh, we all lost a great friend a short time ago, just a few weeks ago. His name is Billy. He lived out in Arizona near Phoenix. If you've ever been sitting near a television and you watch on TV when they're doing the news and you see this dust cloud come across, the wind blows through Arizona, Phoenix particularly. Well, Billy told us that every time that happened, he went home and just got deathly sick. When Billy turned 59 years old, a year and a half ago, he was diagnosed with lung cancer. Listen to this. Lung cancer was not caused by smoking. He had smoked in the past, but he did genomic testing. And they said, nope, it's not cigarette smoke. So Billy says to the doctors, and he had several of them, these oncologists, what's causing it? If cigarette smoking didn't do it, what's going on? We don't know. But line right up, folks. Here is the end result of Billy's quest to get help with his cancer. One of these days in July, I was looking at his records here, a chemotherapy was billed for $25,200. and others in here, 7, 6,000, 2,000, 4,000. This totals $456,000 in 16 months. Here's my point in bringing all of this up. We must create incentive in medical science to cure, and the answer isn't money. Here's $500,000 thrown away because Billy's dead. Oh, the hospitals did fine. It kind of bothers me that despite the fact we lose the patient, we sure get the insurance money. And I know there are expenses in a hospital, and I'm not that kind of a guy to get so sarcastic that I'm saying hospitals should work for free. I do like the idea of a carrot in front of the rabbit. And if he catches the carrot, he gets a reward. I like the idea of paying a hospital $150,000 if you cure my lung cancer. But more importantly, folks, what would happen then is real incentive would occur to fixing lung cancer and breast cancer and prostate cancer and brain cancer. Right now, there just isn't any of that. Whether you fix it or not, cha-ching, the hospital makes $500,000 in 16 months. Create incentive. You know what would happen then? Just like the article I wrote in Oncology News, what would happen then is doctors would put all of the, especially lung cancer patients, this man breathed in a mold probably called Histoplasma capsulatum. It's in the sand, it's in the soil, it's in Arizona. And it mimicked lung cancer perfectly. And he was afraid his smoking was creating the problems. It had nothing to do with his smoking, and doctors didn't know what it did. So the bottom line to this is, I'll give you $50,000 to run me through all of these. And he went through his clinical trials. They're done in hospitals. Of course they want you to do them there. And he didn't win the war. I'm not saying this is bad on the hospital's part. I'm saying someone benefits tremendously when we lose our loved ones, okay? Now, on a brighter note, Susie is talking about something that I think really helps with a lot of conditions. It's called coconut oil. Watch this.
Do you have dry, rough, scaly, or itchy skin? Moisturizers often contain mineral oil, which is derived from petroleum. Why not try coconut oil? I love Simple. Don't you love Simple too? Coconut oil has been used for hundreds of years, and because of its antiviral and antifungal activity, it'll help with eczema and other skin conditions. In fact, you can put some in your favorite conditioner for smooth, shiny hair.
After having read the Fungus Link and the diabetes book, it's eye-opening. It's allowed me to, I guess, feel the joy and the happiness to practice again. A lot of times with my patients, they come into my office and they have questions in regards to various things, and I don't have good answers for them. They've tried various medications, they've tried antibiotics and other things. And honestly, it's very, very difficult to look people in the eye and tell them, I just don't know. I just don't know how I can help you any further. After having read these books and after having spoken with Doug, I feel like there's hope again. I feel like, you know, maybe there's a way for me to now help people that before would have been, you know, basically hopeless. I have to prescribe them the medications, the antifungals, the diflucan, the nystatin, and get them on these diets because it only makes sense. It's logical to me at this point. I feel like if I were to withhold that information from those people, I would not be, you know, upholding my oath that I've taken to help other people. And that's something that I've dedicated my life to. If you came to me now, it'd be, you know, I think diet absolutely is crucial. This is good science, and Doug has shown that.
I was in a health food store the other day, and someone recognized me. You're Doug Kaufman from Know the Cause. And I said, you're kidding. You're right. You know what I miss most about your phase one diet? In a word, bread. So I asked Kristen Kahns to make me some bread that was phase one friendly. Watch this. As I travel across this great country, I get to meet a lot of wonderful people. And one I met several years ago is Kristen Kahns and her husband. And this was a memorable meeting for me because not only did she have a great background in the culinary world, she was a chef, she's also a nutritionist. So into our office she came, into our hearts she came. And today she is going to teach you and me, you know what that is? That, my friends, is called a sandwich. The sandwich, she's not going to make the tomato or make the cheese, but she's going to make the either end, the north and the south end of this. How many of you miss sandwiches, right? With a show of hands. Me too. We can now have a sandwich on a phase one diet. Kristen, the phase one diet says don't feed fungus. I'm convinced millions of us have a fungal disease on board or a fungal germ that is contributing to symptoms and diseases, and doctors don't yet know about this. So starve it for a month by eating sandwiches, peanut butter and jelly, not peanut butter, but almond butter and jelly and so forth. So do tell, do you start in making this bread with a cookie sheet?
I do. I use a cookie sheet and I use a Silpat mat, or you can use parchment paper. You can get this at Bed Bath & Beyond or kind of wherever. So I do love the Silpat mat because you can use it over and over and over and wash it. So it's one of my favorites.
And you start with what?
So I use almond flour. I use blanched almond flour. So the blanched almond flour doesn't have or blanched almonds don't have the skin, so it makes it more of a lighter flour, so you get the same texture as regular bread. And I love this brand, Honeyville. You can buy it online. I've heard you can get it at Costco, but they have 5-pound bags, which I'll freeze it and keep some in the refrigerator, so it lasts me for a long time.
Do you make the bread up in advance?
I do. Well, I'll make a few batches.
Okay.
So I'll make a few batches, and then I will use parchment paper and then a Ziploc bag, and I'll throw it in the freezer.
Wow.
So when I'm craving a sandwich, I've got my healthy bread.
Wow.
Or if I make some soup and I want some bread with it, I just pull it out of the freezer, I'll stick it in the oven or in a toaster or something like that, and I've got it.
When I think of bread, I think of whole wheat or corn bread or, you know, rye bread, something like that, and that's not what we're talking about here. This is a bread that's okay to eat on the phase one diet if you put inside the bread other phase one diet components. This one kind of baffled me.
So the tapioca flour just kind of makes it a little lighter. There's not very much in it. You can not use it if you want, use all almond flour if you want, but it makes it more of a dense kind of different texture. So people are kind of like, oh, this doesn't taste the same. And so this makes it taste like a real bread where people don't complain.
Instead of a sheet of plywood,
yes.
It's like real bread.
Yes.
Okay, good.
Yes. I use a little chia seeds, which helps to bind it together. It gives it great texture, great nutrition.
And it's so good.
And it's so good, for you. A little yogurt, plain organic yogurt, and some eggs, and then you can use whatever seasoning that you want to use on it.
Okay.
You can use cinnamon, you can use Italian seasoning, whatever, but this adobo seasoning by Frontier is great. And I've gotten the question a lot of times that people are dairy-free or they don't want to use eggs, what can they substitute out? Baking is really, really tricky.
Yeah.
And so you substitute one little thing and it's gonna change everything, and then it doesn't taste good, or they don't wanna use the almond flour, they wanna use buckwheat flour, it changes everything. So if you change anything, you're experimenting at your own risk.
Let us know how it turns out.
Yeah, let us know.
We'd love
we'll
to put it
recipe.
On TV. And it comes, see, this is what, how many of you miss peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, right? Well, maybe not the peanut butter, because peanut is commonly contaminated with some of these mycotoxins. But here, you have other butter.
So we'll use some almond butter or sun butter. Mm-hmm. It's made out of sunflower seeds, and so I love the sun butter. It has more of a peanut butter taste because it's roasted.
Yeah.
So I love that. I'll do that. And then if you want to show them the jelly's sugar-free. It's by Nature's Hollow, and it's made with xylitol.
Yeah.
And so it's just a great option for a sugar-free jelly made with good sugar. The xylitol, which is phase one friendly.
Yeah, and so you're combining those two.
Yes, and it's strawberry. So it just has a few ingredients in it, so that's really good. And so you've got your peanut butter and jelly sandwich with any nut butter.
That's okay when the kids come home from school. Chris has dibs on this, our director. He said, don't you dare bite into that or I'm gonna make you 2 inches smaller. Oh no, Chris, you can have it. But I get this one. And what you have in here is other phase. I see a little turkey.
I did, yes. So cheese normally isn't on phase one, but I used this brand. It's yogurt cheese. So it has live, active cultures in it, which is really a good phase one cheese.
It looks so good. It holds so good.
And it's great. I don't eat this all the time. Bread is still, you know, just kind of a treat, but it is a good treat.
It tastes like a real sandwich. Thank you.
You're welcome.
You know, exercising and eating healthy just seem to go hand in hand when it comes to looking your best. That's important. We talk about the phase one diet on our show all the time. And people who exercise actually want to eat better. Not only does exercise make you look more physically attractive, present company excluded, but it sends endorphins into your body, making you feel good too. That's what it's all about. Very few people who exercise want to go have a smoke, a beer, and a hamburger. These traits are apparent, looking good and feeling good, by the people around you and enable you to have more self-confidence when you exercise and eat well. Exercising actually helps build a better you. This isn't something that works for some people. Exercise works for everyone who attempts it. You know, most of the world runs to the pharmacy to pick up their drugs. Kyle Drew says sometimes supplements might help with the same issues. But what about headaches, heartburn, and thinning hair in women? Kyle Drew has this to say about those.
Okay, so you ask about supplement questions. I love supplement questions. I'm kind of a supplement guy. But whenever we answer questions about supplements, we've always got to start with the idea that diet comes first. So many people write and ask us this question. If I don't do the diet, which supplements will help with dot, dot, dot? Well, that question is irrelevant for us because we don't have that. We have a diet philosophy first, and so make sure and stick with the phase one diet. Also, what we don't have is a diagnosis, and we don't have any treatment options for you. We are not your doctor. I'm not a doctor. What we're doing is we're kind of giving you an idea of what people have historically done and what some of your physicians have used over the years for various things. First question is about headaches. This is a big deal. Headaches are happening a lot of times because the diet is wrong, because we are dehydrated. Are you drinking a lot of soda? Be honest. Are you drinking a lot of coffee but not replacing it later with a bunch of water to get in the system and hydrate? You can feel really, really bad if you're not getting enough water. Water and diet are always first. Remember this about fungus too. Doug asked the question, what makes bread rise? Well, that inflammation can cause pain. It can cause pain throughout the entire body, including the head. But what do I like for headaches? Well, I love white willow bark. That's what aspirin is made from, something called white willow bark. I love that. But here's something you might not think about. This is called curcumin. Now, this is a particular brand, and this brand is called Terry Naturally. This is Curamin. I'm not endorsing one brand over another one. I'm just simply saying that if you want some good anti-inflammatory relief, guess what? Spices are one of your best options because it brings down the pain. I forgot to bring something else, but there is a nasal spray, and I can't remember, but it has cayenne pepper in it. I know it sounds ridiculous, but cayenne pepper can actually block the pain receptors, and I have snorted that before, and I think it's called Sinus Blaster, by the way, and it feels so good after the initial heat is gone, and the pain goes away pretty quickly. I love this. Next question that you've asked about, I need supplement suggestions for heartburn. Oh, gosh. Okay, we're going to have to talk a little bit about this real quickly. Heartburn is interesting in that a lot of times we are told that we have too much stomach acid. One day we'll get Dr. Roby Mitchell to talk all about why heartburn actually is usually associated with not enough stomach acid. And so one thing that he and a lot of physicians recommend is something called hydrochloric acid. That's this, HCl. This has pepsin in it also, but HCl, hydrochloric acid, take it with a meal. Do not take it on an empty stomach. Always take this with a meal. It tends to help. Also, good old apple cider vinegar. This is good. Get about a tablespoon, a teaspoon, drink it with water. It feels really good. If you need something right now to kick in immediately, we want to talk about baking soda. It is very alkaline and it helps to neutralize an acidic stomach. And what about this beautiful thing? This is ginger. How about that? She's a beautiful spice. A lot of women take it when they're pregnant and they're starting to feel a little tummy thing going. So this one is important. What's the next question I need supplement suggestions for? Thinning hair for women. John, what were we talking about?
Biotin.
Biotin. That's a big one. Biotin is a nutrient that you can take, and biotin is interesting because it helps nourish the hair, but what else does it do? It helps prevent the fungus that you have on board from turning into a pathological form. That's a disease-causing form. There's a passive form of fungus that just kind of relaxes, and there's an angry pathological form, and biotin prevents that transition. Also, check with your doctor and see if you have anything at all related to thyroid problems or adrenal problems or any other hormone problem. Make sure you check with your doctor for all of these things. Hope these help.
My number one favorite superfood, of course, is raw cacao, otherwise known as raw chocolate. And I probably eat more of it than anyone else in Australia. My number two favorite is maca, the powdered root of a Peruvian cruciferous vegetable. It's the highest growing vegetable in the world and is used particularly for energy and hormone balancing. It works on the hormone centers of the brain, the pituitary, and the hypothalamus to centrally regulate other hormones, including the thyroid gland. New research shows it may have a role in the maintenance of bone mass and the prevention of osteoporosis. Research has also shown it can improve fertility and libido. Quality varies, so choose a good brand. I have a heaped tablespoon every day in a coconut milk smoothie.
Because nutrition can be a pretty overwhelming topic, I think we should revisit the entire organic versus non-organic conversation. In terms of proteins like fish, chicken, eggs, etc., all too often the commercially raised animals are fed foods that they shouldn't eat, like grain and corn for cattle and chickens. This changes the fatty acid content of their meat and makes them less healthy. That would hold true for the eggs from these animals as well. Look for foods that don't have antibiotics or growth hormones added. This is usually true for organic. What worries me now is that the marketing gurus rear their ugly heads and you're out there spending $6 or more on a dozen eggs that are fed an organic corn and grain diet. Guess what? Chickens are supposed to roam around freely eating bugs and earthworms. That's what you need to look for when buying eggs. When buying fish, no farm-raised fish ever. You don't even want to see what a fish farm looks like. When buying beef, it must be grass-fed and grass-finished. Otherwise, it's no better than a corn-fed heifer from a local grocery store. And just because it's from your favorite health food store doesn't make it better. I'm Dr. Fred Pescatore with Food Talk on Know the Cause.
Thank you, Dr. Fred Pescatore. Couldn't agree more with you. Thank you for joining us, folks, and thank you for telling your friends about Know the Cause. Get a copy of this on our website. If you've been diagnosed with cancer, please tell your doctor there's a fourth option. Think fungus. Doc, give me antifungals. I'll go on a phase one diet. Let's see if in 90 days I'm not feeling much better. We do have another option. Thank you for joining us. God bless. Bye-bye.